We needed to do some work around effective record keeping and some understanding of the demographics of our population, which we're doing through the neighbourhood work that we're all working on. And then something around us, de-escalation of operational risks when they're raised. So we have this action plan that we're working on. We are very committed to ensuring that we move from this, requires improvements into good. And this short report is put forward to the council for just confirmation. I just would like to say that one of the services that we did have required improvement for was our sexual health services, which we knew we had some issues with when we took up the contract originally. And we've been working very closely with our commissioners on an action plan anyway. Our KPIs for sexual health are now all green, or and two that are amber moving to green. And our commissioners are working very closely with us on that particular service, which some members might be interested in. But that's the report for the committee to be decided on.
Thank you, Paul. Just before I ask the members if they've got questions, which I'm sure they will do, I have to say, Val, I'm afraid you've drawn the short straw of Karen not being here, really, but this is a very thin report, and I appreciate it was meant to be a verbal report initially. There was a bit of a rush to get to committee services in time, but it paints quite a rosy picture, and it doesn't give me enough detail as far as I'm concerned. I'd like to know what the 14 actions are that the trusts do. I would have liked to have seen that. For me, there just seems a general lack of ownership, that things obviously need to improve, you know, given the CQC report that you had. But yeah, thank you, Beauvoir, for presenting that.
Can I just come back on that? Yeah, sure. We can provide some more details, that's what the committee wants, yes. But I can assure you that the Trust Board, the whole of the Trust Board, is taking the CQC report very, very seriously. We have a very, very detailed action plan. CQC are coming into us every month, and they're looking at services every month with us, starting the week after next. And we want to work with CQC, because if they've got areas of good practice that they can share with us, then we're very, very interested to talk to them, about that. We feel really strongly that we want to provide an absolute best care for the people of Wirral. And although this report was disappointing, we aren't looking at it through rose tinted spectacles, and I don't want people to see that. We're taking it really, really seriously. And in actual fact, we don't want to be good next time, we want to be outstanding. And all of our staff are on board with wanting to help us to achieve that.
Thank you, Val. Now, I know that there will be quite a number of questions, so I'll take Lesley first, please, and then Moira.
Yeah, thank you, Chair, and thank you, Val. I mean, my question is really centred around what Councillor McManus has said. I have to say I'm really disappointed in what's been presented tonight. It's a couple of pages, which when people who read the rating that the hospital actually achieved, in the Wirral were saying to me, what's going to happen, with our hospital, what steps are they taking to improve that? It's unusual for us to have, for us as a council anyway, and I can only relate to try and make it similar to what we would ask for, where we have an Ofsted and we're rated, or we have an inspection, particularly in children's services, and wanting to talk about that, but our first reaction is, what are the points that clearly have brought CQC to arrive at that decision on that particular rating? What steps are going to be taken? In other words, as the chairman said, an action plan we would want to see, and personally where there's an action plan, I want to see how you're going to make that improvement journey and what people and time scales are actually detailed to take us along that route. So, when can we then, as not people who are employed, most of us in the health service, but when can we as the representatives of the people have sight of that action plan and how you're going to improve this for us so that we in turn can inform the residents who quite clearly are concerned about it?
Can I just confirm, I think what you meant, Leslie, was the community trust.
Yes, so,
thanks for that, and I'm sure we are all convinced that we do want to provide a service which is outstanding, but at the moment it isn't, and we would like to be able to help you to get to that position. And the way that we would like you to do that is by adding a recommendation to the report tonight, which will say that we would like you to present your improvement plan to the health and care panel, and that over the course of the between now and the end of the municipal year, we would like to be able to track the progress on the different work streams you've got to bring about that improvement. And I'm going to put that forward as a recommendation to try to bring forward.
Can I just say, I think that's really, really helpful, and it's good to know that we all want to work together to achieve that improvement.
Thank you. So basically there isn't a full report, and that's because there's some outstanding things and good things that were raised by some QC. So if I just single some of them out, basically there isn't a full report, because there were some really good things in practice that were reported on. Not particularly singling things out, but the bits where the management team are promoting a positive culture, it was outstanding practice with the breast milk bank. Page 12, leaders were visible and approachable. Managers shared essential information at meetings, and financial pressures were managed so they didn't compromise quality of care. All those things sound very positive. And when we look at the section on children, page 19, as you see, the culture throughout was focused on high quality, sustainable care, and staff spoke with passion. And the same with adults, because when things went wrong, staff apologised and gave patients honest information and suitable support. And you said sexual health was some issues. I noticed in that bit, staff were reported as speaking in a respectful way, and the management team were promoting a positive culture. So look at the good bits. What I'm puzzled about is the disconnect between the good bits and the bits that receive some criticism. So I hope that I'll just nip for those. Wearing local council hat, we're interested in safeguarding and improvement of our children's services and making. So when we read that children, records of conversations and information relating to safeguarding concerns were not consistently recorded, that's in page 18. And it was a problem. We saw examples where senior managers did not have full oversight of concerns. On page 25, there was a disconnect in communications between staff above band 7 and staff below. So there are some things that are puzzling. Because when we're told that there's a lack of evidence that the voices of all staff are heard and acted upon, and managed interest and action on health and well-being of staff was below national average, little alarm bells start ringing and think, well, where are the problems? So if, when you come back to us, you can say what we've done to tackle things and how things are improving, we'd be grateful.
Well, taking on board everything everybody said, which I fully agree with, I do feel that this report is bad in so many ways. Because you've sat here, you've known, you've heard the arguments that have raged over not getting reports. This isn't a report, is it? It's somebody's view of a report. And having been a school governor for many years, we all know how the head can report his Ofsted or her Ofsted, which isn't quite like the paperwork that you get. And that's the problem. As Phil's highlighted, there are good things, but you read this and immediately I'm suspicious. Well, what are they hiding? Why aren't they giving us the report? Why aren't they showing us the improvement plan? And that's the danger when you do this sort of thing. And it is a problem.
Okay, would you like to come back on
my
story? Sorry,
I didn't say it's on the short story.
I think that Simon just wanted to come in, if that's okay, just from the Commissioner's perspective, and then I'll come back.
Just from a commissioning point of view, from World Health and Care Commissioning, since these reports have been published and have been put into public domain, the next steps for us have been to meet with the Care Quality Commission, NHS Improvement as the regulatory body for the providers, and NHS England as the regulatory body for ourselves as the commissioners. And then what we do is we go through each of the pieces of evidence presented. And this will segue nicely into when Janelle gives her report, because it's exactly the same process for both organisations. We then bring them together in that action plan format, which I'm very glad the council have got promotion to health, pet and care performance panel thing. That's the place you wish to look at quality accountancy and use surveillance. It's absolutely the right place for us to collectively to bring both of those reports to you. That then develops a matrix which then we have further discussions, because there are some times where CQC goes and says something and they perhaps just have that evidence from the trust to back up what the trust is saying. So it's another opportunity for the trust to evidence what they're doing and for them to have another conversation with CQC and invite them back in as that part of that improvement journey. So we're doing with both organisations. We're both organisations on what we call enhanced surveillance of their contracts. We've got a meeting together with Janelle and the hospital trust next week. And it's a continuing process we'll be going through. So when it comes to health and care performance panel, I'm hoping we'll have some really tangible concrete that you can start having a look at.
I think
staff who are transferred across from the authority to the community trust. that we went about that was to send out an email to all staff who were affected by the transfer and ask them to provide feedback to the anonymous. So it was emails that were then redacted with names, email addresses, so no one but myself knew that who the staff were to obviously make sure we're getting truthful and accurate reflections really. So we've sort of split that into key themes. Part of the super transfer, there's a number of key themes, and main one being using two sets of policies and procedures. So at the moment we are working to local authority in terms of conditions and looking into trust and NHS terms and conditions. When they are reviewed, then we'll be in the process of being a single policy and procedures again. So it will be NHS terms and conditions once they are reviewed and ratified. 4 days on paid leave has been a bit of a bugbear to a lot of staff really. Understand the local authority just changed the way their 4 days leave are being used. So with regards to ourselves, one of the days was after the bank holiday in August. 3 of the days of them were going to be used across the Christmas period. So it's the fact that from staff perspective we've transferred across, NHS colleagues aren't having to have them paid leave really, well, where we are. Pay leave as well was a major issue, which did cause hardship. There was communication sent out and staff were asked to notify their managers when there were any hardship cases, and then they would have had interim payments, etc. prior to pay leave being due. That was all set up, and only a small number of staff, I think, were affected by that, which do probably like that. Operational issues, IT has been a bit of concern, new systems, new laptops, etc. That has been put in place, has been rectified, and staff are aware that there was IT clinics, drop-in sessions, etc. put in place for staff. So it is being rectified slowly but surely. There's an issue on recruitment. Has been raised by staff as well, but there is now role in recruitment process that being put in place, but there has been agencies that have to use to fill any vacancies or any gaps. There is an issue with practice educators, which is being looked at moment. We have practice educators who are placing for students, doing social work, will visit teams, spend time with teams and gain valuable experience really. Staff who were in practice educator role, they received £1,000 lump sum. That, since the transfer of cost, that seems to have stopped really. So the universities were paying the local authority separate, and practice educators were being paid £1,000 once the student completed their placement. I think that's being looked at, but we haven't got an answer on that as of yet. Yeah, that was an overview from the theme really that were raised from staff. Anyone want any questions?
Can I take questions?
Please, Tony.
Just like to thank you for that report. You know, hearing from the frontliners and that perspective is really important for our group, really. I would like to see that on a regular basis. Could you provide that in a written format for us?
Certainly, yeah.
Lesley? Yeah. Thanks for that report. Just a question, you mentioned agency staff, and clearly agency staff come at a higher cost than usually, I'm sure they do in your case. Just wondering, have you got any plans to try to encourage those agency staff to become permanent staff of the organisation at all? I know that we're trying to do that with their children's social care, you know, if we have agency staff, maybe they offer.
I think what is good for them is that they, through working on that, in our services by an agency, they get to see how, you know, how our services work, whether it fits for them as much as it fits for us. It's quite a test run for them. But yes, yes, we're certainly happy to tune and ask them for those come to our books, which is good. I think the important thing is that Dan said is that we have a rolling recruitment process. As soon as we finish one, then we go straight out to advert for another. So almost every 3 months there's an advert that goes out to 200 people from the workforce. If I can just say about the practice educator role, this I picked it, this up actually last week as an issue, because I went to have one of the social workers for the afternoon, which was a really good experience for me. She was explaining to me about this payment, and I said that can't be right because, you know, she chipped across with that allocation of resource. So I've asked HR to look into that for us because she should be being paid, and then that has been paid back. And I was sort of the last thing.
Thank you. I'll take
Bruce
and then Mary, please.
Thank you. I think you mentioned in your report about the transition between one organisation to another and the sort of difficulty with the pay structure. Is this to do with pay dates? Do we not align in some way?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
There
was a 2 week difference in pay dates, so council paid 18th of the month and just once in a day. So that caused some hardship for some members and staff, yeah.
Okay, can I just come back in here, please? I was involved in a similar thing a number of years ago. I used to be a shop steward in the aircraft industry. And when we moved to a different structure such as that, we went midway with the pay dates. And we set up allowances for people from the hardship, which was repayable over the course of the year, 2 years, whatever it takes. Have you considered that at all?
Yeah, that was done. To be fair, there was staff were asking for a course hardship to notify their manager. You could obviously escalate that to HR. And I think there was money taken out then each month to cover what was paid.
Okay.
Chair, I was just wanted to ask about practice educators as well, because it's been something I've worked with during the time at the NHS in various roles, and currently I'm now dealing with the university as well. I have found in my time dealing with the university that if there's a cut-off date, they just stop, and really they need an invoice or some paperwork to tell them to start paying.
Thank you, that's very helpful. I'll check that that's what's happening. I think at the moment the route is that it still comes through the council and it's part of our contract. So we just need to review that. I think the most important thing for me is if somebody's doing that duty, then they should be recognised for it. So that's the way we're doing that.
Okay, if we've got no further questions,
do you do such a thing? I remember when I was working with the Mayor's Travel, we used to do staff surveys on a regular basis. Do you do anything like that, but jointly with the trade unions?
So there's a national staff survey for the NHS, which comes out every year. In fact, it's due out in the next couple of weeks, to which obviously all social care staff will be part of that this time, as opposed to being included by us. And we take the results of the staff survey really seriously, because that gives us a barometer of what it is that the whole workforce feels, and then we have to again have an action plan that looks at that. So yes, we do get some of the staff survey, it's across all the NHS.
Thank you.
I
just have it's a similar vein of question to ask the one, but I was wondering around how safe or comfortable staff feel in feeding things back to their managers. So for example, when you mentioned transition to pay day, and you said staff could flag to their managers if they were going to be in a position of hardship for those 2 weeks or so. I guess my first kind of question person, your name will be taken off, it will be anonymised. Whether people feel like their emails are read or whether they feel like someone can intercept, I do wonder if an actual kind of a portal of some sort, or just a really simple survey that was that felt really anonymous, would get a more genuine quality of feedback from staff that could then maybe look a little bit deeper at some of the issues.
Do you think
there's
a look at that? I think as Captain Howard has asked for it,
okay, thank you. Can I just wrap up by thanking both Val and Dan for coming along and giving us your very personal insight. Thank you. And we're moving backwards now on the agenda, so we're now going to take item number 4, which is the financial monitoring report, pages 11 to 42. And Matthew Cox, you'll take us through that, I believe.
So as you can see, for instance, we spent £3 million this year increasing the fee rates to care providers. £2 million, which is being used or estimated to be used to meet the additional demographic growth of an increase in the elderly population, on the way around some increases in the number of young people with disabilities. And there are also pre-agreed savings as part of the medium-term financial plan, which needs to be answered as well. So indeed, if you look down at the bottom of the item in brown, additional cost pressures this year are such that an efficiency target of £3 million is needed in order to balance the budget this year and the department's draw. An efficiency plan in conjunction with the departments in the NHS in order to meet that target. That's as much as I'd like to go through the presentation on the current revenue budget forecast. I'd like to spend a little bit of time now talking about the pooled fund and the pooled budget that the council has with CCG. So the bullet points there can cover everything that I want to discuss. It is the primary means which the council is using to meet growing demand for health care services. The intention is that there is better outcomes for service users because it creates a more timely cohesive service and gives service users better access to health and care services. And that pool fund in 2017-18 includes the existing better care fund, but also includes packages of care for learning disability service users in the mental health area, children with disabilities, continuing care and personal health budgets within the CCP. Total pool plan is £130 million this year and that is forecast to balance this year also. You can see then there's a composition of that £130 million, so what's obvious there is that the better care fund makes up not quite enough, but certainly a large majority of that pool fund. Adult social care contributes just under £40 million worth into there, the CCG, public health and children to make up the difference. Moving on from the pool budgets, I thought we'd got an opportunity to talk about the old age disability service as well, which is now in form in place. What this does, the old age disability service, it builds on existing relationships between the department and the health service. The mental health team has been co-located actually with Chequering Local Partnership, CWP, since the 90s. And on the 19th of August, 120 full-time equivalent social care posts transferred to CWP in exactly the same way as the transfer occurred in 2017 to the Community Trust. So what that means is that there's a delegation of statutory duties for the assessment and support planning functions for children, young people and adults with complex disabilities and mental health issues to CWP. And that service redesign is designed to improve accessibility to service users by having a single pathway access to services for anybody with those complex needs. Having spoken about the pool and integrated arrangements that we have with health, I'd like to talk a little bit now about our service user numbers and some of the activity data in social care at the minute. What we have here is a comparison between the end of last financial year and the end of quarter one of this financial year. And these are numbers of people in receipt of each of those types of care in the what's called the neighbourhood profile. So these are typically our older people, 65 plus age. As you can see, the numbers of people in receipt of residential and nursing care have remained fairly static, just an increase of 5 there over the last quarter. There has been a more noticeable increase in the number of people in receipt of community care, which in the older people's market is predominantly childcare, heavily versus home. And the decrease in short-term care, the 17.1% decrease in the number of people receiving short-term care, you mainly explain the need to seasonal variation. The figures presented in March would include an element of additional winter pressure beds, which are formed at that time of the year, which then come out over some period when it was actually mandatory. Remember, I thought that might be useful just by way of comparison. What you're looking at here is a comparison. The pie chart on the left shows you the proportion of volume in the department. So 53% of the people that looked after the 65 plus group access community care, and then 29% are taken care of in some type of care setting. compared with cost, which is on the right, which shows that actually, if we take the yellow segment, for example, 29% of the 65 plus population within social care and access to residential and nursing care would actually account for 47% of the total expenditure. Conversely, although over half of the service users that we have elderly people use community care, it accounts for barely one third of our total expenditure. And that's just by way of comparison, that's simply because the average cost of looking after the service user in long-term residential nursing care is shared over £500 a week. The cost of looking after somebody in community care setting is under half of that. Similar comparison here for our complex care, which is predominantly the 18 to 64 year old category. Most of the service users in this group are learning disabilities and mental health, but this also does include higher levels of physical disabilities as well. There is a slightly inverse message here compared to the older people's population. What you can see is a slight increase in demand for residential and nursing care services, and a slight, albeit marginal, decrease in demand for community care services. That being said, as the next pie chart will show, there is more so than this in the older people's market. There is a significant majority of people within complex care or after within a community setting, with only just over 20% of service users look after in a care environment. Again, the message probably isn't quite as pronounced here, but it is consistent. 21% of people look after in complex care account for 31% of the costs, and the average cost of residential care package here is approximately over £900 a week. Compared to the community care setting, where the average cost of factory care here is around £540 a week. So there is quite a marked difference between the cost of delivering care depending upon which model is most appropriate for that service user. Mm-hmm. The final thing that I said I wanted to talk about was the capital schemes, and to give a brief overview of both the October 17-18, which you can see in front of you here, and also to look at the out of the quarter one position, I should say, for 2018-19. So the total schemes in 17-18 total 1.7 million, of which two-thirds were spent. You can see yourselves the descriptions of those schemes. Roughly £459,000 wasn't spent and was slipped into the 18-19 project. For all three of those areas, so the citizen portal, the assistive technology, and county board, what wasn't completed in 17-18 has been slipped into the scheme to be completed in 18-19. And this is what the 18-19 scheme currently looks like. I am aware that the capital report for quarter one is slightly different in your accountant. So this is the current council scheme as of 18-19, it's just over £5 million programme. Looking at Pensbywood first, the remodelling and the internal refit of Pensbywood has been completed and has provided significant benefit for those service users. So although the budget for that is £179,000, that piece of work is now effectively complete, so there will be slippage there. The extra care scheme, or the number of extra care schemes, which comprise the £3 million that we have here, were put on hold while the government consulted on the cap of local housing allowance rate for social management development. A new model for a new funding model for supported housing is going to be implemented from April 2020, and providers are now starting to revive their plans for extra care houses.